Hi all, so today I'm back with the second part of Light, chapter 10. In this part, we are going to see spherical mirrors. We have seen one introduction earlier. So today we are going to see spherical mirrors in detail. So before that, I'll show you some types of mirror. This is plane mirror. We can see that its reflecting surface is flat. So that's why we call it as a plane mirror, right? So now this one, second one, is convex mirror. Convex mirror, if you remember, it's like the inside of a spoon, curved inwards. You can't actually see the curve, but if you touch it, you will feel. That's a polyacid. Now third one is the convex mirror, which is bulged outwards. Ignore the background, please, okay? So this is bulged outwards, which is the convex mirror. Now, why are these mirrors known as spherical mirrors? I had told you in the last class also, these mirrors are actually cut out from a sphere, but it doesn't look like a sphere, no? Okay, so if we complete the curve like this, we'll understand that the reflecting surface is part of a sphere. It was actually a part of a big glass sphere and it was cut out. Now, if you cut a small part out and polish its outer surface so that inner surface becomes reflecting, it is a concave mirror. But if its inner surface is polished, it becomes a convex mirror. Now, we'll discuss some terms. The center of the reflecting surface is called pole, which we denote by P, capital P. So, this is the pole of the mirror, which is the exact center of the reflecting surface. Now, since it is from a sphere, the center of the sphere is known as center of curvature. So, it is the center point of the sphere from which the mirror was cut out. Then, this radius of that sphere is known as radius of curvature. Now, if you draw a line connecting P and C, this is known as principal axis, and you can see that it is perpendicular to the reflecting surface. Now, another important, the midpoint of C and P is called the focal point, and the length of focal point to the pole is known as focal length of the mirror. Now, one important assumption that we make is that aperture of the mirror is always very less compared to radius of curvature. Aperture means the part of the mirror which is exposed to light. Now, what will happen if you cover the top and bottom part of the mirror? A less part will be exposed and the aperture will reduce. So basically, aperture means the length of the reflecting surface of the mirror. And here we assume that this is very less as compared to the radius of curvature. We all are familiar with rear view mirrors, where it's written objects seen in the mirror are closer than they appear. So these are actually convex mirror and they are used because they have a wide area. Now we know that when a parallel beam of light falls on convex mirror, they diverge, and that's why they are known as diverging mirrors. Now we'll see some important rules that we have to follow using a convex mirrors. If a ray of light comes parallel to the principal axis and falls on the convex mirror, it will be reflected such that the reflected ray appears to be passing through the focus, or it will be diverged in such a way. So this is the first rule that we have to follow when we draw ray diagrams or see image formation. Second rule, if the incident ray comes directed towards the focus, the center of curvature, you will see that this is actually falling perpendicular to the reflecting surface. And we know that whenever the incident ray is perpendicular to the reflecting surface, it retraces its path back. So if the incident ray is directed towards center of curvature, the reflected ray will follow the same path back. It will retrace the path. Coming to the third rule, if the incident ray is directed towards the focus, then it is the opposite. The reflected ray will go parallel to the principal axis. So this is the opposite of the first rule. And we have to see that the second law of reflection is followed everywhere. Now, if the incident ray is making some angle I with the principal axis, it will the reflected ray will also make the same angle with the principal axis. This is actually the second law of reflection. So you have to keep in mind these four laws while we are studying image formation by convex mirrors. Now this mirror, you will be familiar if you've gone to a dentist. This is known as a dentist mirror. He uses to see the tooth in your mouth so that he can see an enlarged image of the teeth. So this is an example of concave mirror. Now we know that if a set of parallel light falls on a concave mirror, they converge. That's why it's called as a converging mirror. Now same rules are followed there. A ray parallel to the principal axis passes through the focus. If it goes through the center of curvature, it will come back on the same path. Third rule, if the ray of light is incident through the focus, it will be reflected parallel to the principal axis. And if it makes an angle I, the reflected ray will make an angle R, which is equal to the incident angle, following the laws of reflection. Now we'll see image formation by concave mirror. So I have taken one concave mirror, focal length 15 centimeter. You can get a full set from Amazon. It's hardly 400-500 rupees. Then what you have to do, you have to draw principal axis, means a line, and then on that you have to mark P, F and C, these three points, pole, focal length and center of curvature, and all should be 15 centimeter apart. P and F 15 centimeter, F and C 15 centimeter. Then place your concave mirror on a mirror holder. Again, this comes with the set on P. Now first case, I have kept the image at very far from the mirror, which is at infinity. And from the mirror, okay, this is case one when the object is at infinity, means really far away from the mirror. Now we'll see how to get the image. You have to take a white sheet of paper. I didn't have a plain white, so I've taken ruled, but better if you take a white, plain white sheet of paper, and then somewhere near focus, from there you can start and keep moving the paper front and back till you get an image of the diya or of the light source on the white sheet of paper. Now after adjusting the paper, I can see a really tiny spot on the paper. I hope you can see it. And then when I'm moving it front, it disappears. And again when I bring it back, I can see that tiny little spot. So we have got almost the image at the focus. So these are the characteristics of image when the object is at infinity. Position is at the focus. Size was very point size that you can hardly see. And nature is real. How do I say that? Because I have obtained it on a paper, on a screen. It means it is real. And since it's real, it is inverted, because it's really hard to tell if real or inverted since the image was really tiny. So same thing we'll do with other cases, means we'll keep bringing the object closer to the mirror and then find out what happens to the image. Now we'll see second case where the object is kept beyond C, means closer to infinity but after C. So again we'll keep the paper like this and try to obtain the image of the diya. Okay, you have to adjust the paper slightly so that you get an image, a clear image of the diya. And here you can see I have got the image, and this is somewhere between C and F, means center of curvature and F. So the object is formed between C and F. Its size is small, not point but still small, and the nature is real and inverted. Third case is where I keep the object at C, at the point C, and again you have to do the same thing using the screen. So the same procedure you can repeat for positions at C and other positions. Now we'll try to draw the ray diagram and verify these cases using ray diagram. So here at P, I'll draw my concave mirror like this. Again, now I have to draw the reflect the polished side. See, these lines, they represent the polished side. So these are very important, guys, because if you don't draw this side, you will not know whether it is a concave mirror or a convex mirror, and then you lose marks for this in the exam. So never forget to do this. Now this is case one, that we had kept the diya very far away, right? So this is at infinity when the object is very very far away from the mirror. Okay, so what kind of rays do you get from an object at infinity? Parallel rays. If you remember, last video I had told we get a parallel beam of light from an object at infinity. So if an ray comes parallel to the principal axis, it has to pass through the focus. The reflected ray should pass through the focus. Then again, one more incident ray, which is again parallel to principal axis. This will also have to pass through the focus. This is our rule that we had studied, right? So it will pass through the focus. Now, where do these reflected rays meet? We get the image where the reflected rays meet. So here the reflected rays meet at the focus here, and you can see that the image is very small. Going to the second case, where the object is now beyond C, means it's not as far as infinity but closer, but still it is beyond C. Then I'll take one incident ray which is parallel to principal axis. What will happen to it? It will get reflected and then pass through the focus like this. Okay, there are few tips when you are drawing ray diagram so that you want to get maximum marks. First of all, use a very sharp pencil, okay, and use a scale, and then don't overdraw. If you are making some mistake, you erase and draw. You should never draw double lines, that will all make mistakes. So now another incident ray I am taking, which is passing through focus. So now what should happen to an incident ray which passes through focus? Yes, it will go parallel to the principal axis. This is rule number 2, if you remember. Okay, now where do these reflected rays meet? Another tip, never forget the arrows. Arrows carry half marks. If you don't put arrows, you will be losing your marks. So be very 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 careful. Okay, now where do these meet? This point between C and F. So since we started from the tip of the arrowhead, at this point you'll get the tip of the arrowhead, and then you can work to the principal axis. You will see here the image is smaller as compared to your object. So the position of the object is between C and F, and the so these are the characteristics. Position is between C, center of curvature, and focus, and size of the image is smaller. You call it as diminished also. So you get a diminished image, even though it is not point size, but it is diminished, and the nature is real and inverted. Third case, when the object is at C, same incident ray I am taking, which is parallel to principal axis, it will pass through focus like this. Now second incident ray I will take, which is passing through focus. Now you all know what will happen to it. It will be reflected parallel to the principal axis. You guys can actually practice these ray diagrams with me, okay? These are very very important. They do come in exam 100%. So you have seen that we are proving the same things that we got from the experiment here using the ray diagrams. So here, since my measurements are not very proper, my scale is smaller, I'm not getting exactly at C, but you can see that almost you will get the image at C. With proper scale and sharp pencil, you will get it properly. So the position is at C, at the center of curvature, means at the same point where you had kept the object. Size is again the same size as that of the object, and the nature is real and inverted. So in the same way, you can do the fourth case, which is between C and F. So now you've brought the object closer to the mirror between C and F. Again, same incident ray I'll take, which is parallel to principal axis. and this will pass through the focus. Okay, I'm struggling with the size of my scale, but I'm sure you can do it better on a paper. So I'll extend this ray. See, one more ray you can take, which I have not used it till now, but you might have seen in your books, the ray that passes through the center of curvature. So where will that kind of ray go? That will be reflected through the same. So it doesn't matter which two incident rays you use. The funda is that you just have need at least two reflected rays so that you can see the point of intersection, and there you'll get the image. So this is my favorite one. That's why I'm using this. Which passes through the focus and goes parallel to the principal axis. Yes. So the reflected ray in this case will go parallel to the principal axis. Now where do the reflected rays meet? Yes. Beyond C. This is actually the opposite of second case, you can see. So here I'll get the tip of the arrowhead and then I'll draw the rest of the arrow. This is beyond C. So position of the image we are getting beyond C. Now you can see the size of the image is larger than the size of the object. So the size is enlarged. So position is beyond C. And size larger than the object means enlarged, and nature is obviously real and inverted. I'm saying real because the rays are actually meeting at some point, so that's why they're real, and real means they will be inverted. So same things you can do. So same using the same procedure we can do for the next two cases, which is at F and between F and P. So this is a summary of what we are going to get. Only in the last case you will get a virtual and erect image, because the rays, they will be diverging, so you will have to produce them backwards, so they won't actually meet, they will appear to meet. So in that case, whatever image is formed, that is erect. Now we'll discuss sign conventions. These are very important for numericals. So in this pole of the mirror, it is taken as a origin, means the center. Okay, if you consider XY axis, that will be the origin. The principal axis is taken as the X axis. For example, this is a concave mirror. This principal axis becomes your X axis and the pole is the origin. This will be your origin. This is x-axis. Okay. Now all the distances, it's you have to compare it to the xy coordinate system that you already studied, right? Object is always placed left to the mirror. The one that we drew, ray diagram, in that I had kept it right to the mirror, which is against the convention, but I did that so that it is understood to you that both are correct. The only thing is, in the conventional way, we draw it to the left. So towards the left one you'll find in the book. So all the distances which are left side are taken as negative, and all are measured parallel to the principal axis. Then all the distances which are measured right of the pole, means behind, backside of the mirror, they are considered as positive, while all which are towards the left are negative. It is same as your XY coordinate system, how we do all to the left of the origin, the numbers are negative, and right of the origin, numbers are positive. Now going up and down, above the principal axis, perpendicular measures are all positive, and below them are negative, means along the y-axis. It's very same as your Cartesian coordinate system. So nothing to get confused there. So this is clear, I hope. All the distances above the principal axis are positive, means if the image is erect, its height will be positive. If the image is inverted, height will be negative because it is below the principal axis. I'll show you in this diagram now. this is the pole. Suppose this is the object which is kept at the left hand side, okay, AB. This is opposite to what ray diagram I showed you before, where the object was kept right hand side. So the only difference is, always according to the conventions, direction of incident light is considered as positive. So if you are drawing the object on the right side, you can take the direction of the incident light, means towards left, as positive. So that is what makes all the difference, direction of incident light. So here I'll show like this. So direction towards incident light is all positive, and the opposite direction, means towards the left, will always be negative. It means that the object is always kept on the left side, right, in front of the mirror. So the object's distance from the mirror will always be negative u. And if the images are formed real and inverted, again they will be formed on the same side as that of the object. So the distance of the image v for real images will be negative, and for virtual images it will become positive. And same for erect images, the height is upward, so it will be positive, and downwards is negative. Now we'll go to one very important formula called the mirror formula. Derivation of this formula you'll study in 12th standard, but this formula is very important because you will have to solve many questions. So it relates focal length, distance of image, and distance of object. 1 by f equal to 1 by v plus 1 by u. Here f is focal length, u is object's distance from the mirror. So this is measured from the pole along the principal axis. So object's distance from the mirror is u, and image's distance from the mirror is v. And F stands for focal length, distance of focus from the pole. So this is mirror formula, very, very important. Derivation you will study in higher classes. Next concept is magnification. Magnification means it is a how big an image you are getting, or how small an image you are getting as compared to the real size of the object. So you can find that out by finding the ratio of height of the image, okay, size of the image to the ratio of to the size of the object. So you have to just divide the size of the image to size of the object. So it is basically a comparison of size of the image to that of the object, so that you can understand whether the image is bigger or smaller. So h dash here is size of image divided by size of object. Alternate formula is m equal to minus v by u. Again, how you got this, you will study in higher classes derivation. This formula, m equal to minus v by u, is known as magnification formula. Again, very important for the numericals. So which of these you use, it depends on what is given in the question. So comparing both the formula, you'll get h dash by h equals to minus v by u. So you can use these relations to find out the unknown stuff given in the questions. Now, magnification gives you a very important detail about the object. Suppose the object is diminished, okay, you have a smaller object, then obviously image's size will be smaller than that of the object size, or h dash by h is less than 1. Taking h this side, h dash by h is m, so m is less than 1. If the image is enlarged, means you are getting a bigger image, greater size, then h dash means a size of image will be greater than size of object, or h dash by h is greater than 1, or h dash by h is m, so m is greater than 1. What does it mean? It means that if you have a magnification less than 1, it means the object is diminished, and if you get magnification larger than 1, object is enlarged. Now we'll be doing one problem related to the mirror formula. An object is placed in front of a convex mirror of focal length 15 cm at a distance of 10 cm from the mirror. Find position, nature, and magnification of the image. Right, position here of the image means you have to find out V. So we'll write down all that is given. U is the object distance, which is minus 10 cm. Why minus? Because it is towards the left of the mirror. Now F is 15 cm, but what is the sign? Positive, because convex mirror's focal length lies on the right side. Then V is the image distance that you have to find out. So why is F positive? I'll clarify right now. Suppose I have a concave mirror here, okay? Now we are drawing this, imagining that the object is placed on the left side according to convention. So if I complete the sphere here from which it is cut out, the radius lies on the left side. So its focal length also will lie on the left side because focal length is the midpoint. So since it is towards the left, focal length of a concave mirror is always negative. Understood? Now same thing I'll do for the convex mirror. If you complete the sphere for the convex mirror so that the object lies on the left side, this said object is lying according to sign conventions, so its radius is towards the right because the sphere, if you'll complete it, comes towards the right, and F is midpoint, so F is also positive. So for convex mirrors, focal length is positive always, and for concave mirror, focal length is always negative. So please keep this in mind, you'll get all the questions right, and U is always negative. So now we have written everything given. So we have to now simply apply our mirror formula, 1 by F equal to 1 by V plus 1 by U. Substitute all these values here. F is minus 15, so it becomes plus 15, so it becomes 1 by 15 equal to 1 by V plus 1 by U, which is 10, which is negative. Okay, so I'll make it minus 10. So 1 by V plus minus becomes minus 1 by 10. Transposing 1 by 15, 1 by V this side, 1 by 15 plus 1 by 10. Right. Now we will take the LCM of 15 and... So LCM is 30, 2 plus 3, which is 5 by 30. Now this is 1 by V. So we have to make it reciprocal, which is V is 30 by 5. This is an area where most children make mistake. You forget to make the reciprocal and get the answer wrong. So answer is 6 centimeter. This is the position. Now this is positive 6. What does it tell you about the image? If this is your convex mirror, I'll draw it the other way so that it is easy for you. So that the object comes at the left side. So this is your convex mirror. Object is here. And it is plus 6, means it lies, the image lies to the right side. So this is what kind of image if you get it on the right side? Yes, it is a virtual image, and since it's virtual, it will be erect. So nature of the image is virtual and erect. Now we'll find out the magnification is called minus V by U. So minus V we found out to be 6. And U is minus 10 centimeter, which is 3 by 5. So 3 by 5 is obviously less than 1. So our image formed is diminished in nature, because we had already seen if magnification is less than 1, then the object, then the image is diminished, means smaller than the object. So guys, that was the end of today's class. If you have any doubts or you think I've missed out something, please do ask in the comment section. And in case if you're interested in doubt clarification sessions, again you can contact me. I'm also putting my email ID in the description box. So please do watch the video and try out all the experiments that I told. You can get all the optical instruments from Amazon, the concave mirror, convex mirror and all. I'll put the link of that Amazon also in the description box. So please try out and make physics fun for you. Okay, so I stay in Mangalore. If anyone near Mangalore wants online sessions or any doubt clarifications or tuitions, you can contact me in the comment box or in my mail ID. Okay, bye for today. I'll be back with the next part of the video. So stay tuned till then.